I was scared to look out here. Y'all give it up for Beth Snap. Yeah. She's awesome. She's awesome. Go buy her shit if she's still here. Walk back there and buy some shit. Johnston out of Nashville, Cadillac Dream. Something real. You were asleep. Yeah, I could feel you breathe. I still love how that made me feel.
Yeah.
so I just waved goodbye. I took a step, let out my breath, and I stared straight in that sky.
Thank you.
Y'all give it up for Mr. Noah Denton back here on drums. This guy's still in middle school. Literally, I'm not making that up. 14 years old. Yeah. So, all you ladies that are out here drinking, want to say something to him later. He's only 14. He's only 14. Gentlemen, too. He's only 14.
Music in just a minute, but first I want to introduce you to the man whose vision is Five Points Music Sanctuary. This is founder Tyler Godsey. Thank you for inviting us in tonight. We really appreciate being here.
Well, I'm really happy we could host you here and play a wonderful show with you all. That's fantastic.
Now, how did you find, this is an old church. How did you find this? How did you and this old church come together?
Well, this church had been here since 1929, so there have been a lot of people that have brought a lot of energy into this place over the years. I first started working with this back in late 2013, 14, had a couple of events here. And then it had a bunch of different uses in the meantime. It was a yoga studio, it was a sort of an event space, it was a contractor's office. And I remember I was working at the Roanoke Valley Allegheny Regional Commission. Fantastic group of people, fantastic job. And I saw the building, went up for sale, and a month later it went up for a contract. And I felt like there was this moment that sort of just ran away from me. This opportunity, these ideas that I have here aren't something that just manifested overnight. They're things that have simmered and come to fruition over the many years that I've been around. You know, a lot of this didn't really come to fruition until I had my first son. I have two children, both are deaf. My son Forrest was born about 9 years ago. And when he was born, just as my daughter was, they were both born deaf. And at 11 months old, we were able to give them both the gift of sound with cochlear implants. It's that gift of sound that serves as the inspiration for everything you see here. Here we celebrate sound, we embrace it, and we pursue it. But we don't just do that through shows that bring people together. Rather, we use our shows as a platform to talk about programs and fund programs like music therapy and hearing loss advocacy. And so when this space became available, as the contract sign was up there, my heart dropped. And I had this whole vision that I felt like was going to go away, and it wasn't going to happen. And when the contract fell through, I knew at that moment that I had to take a chance. And I put in my notice at work, and about 3 years later, here I am today, doing what I do. But when we talk about the power of sound, it's a much more innate concept on the other end of the spectrum. I go back to when we turned on my son's ears, and he was 11 months old, and my wife leaned over, and her very first words were, "I love you." Now, these are words that have been said to me thousands of times throughout my life, but up until then, it never hit me like that day. It was emotional and mental and physical, spiritual. And at its core, that's exactly what we talk about when we talk about the power of sound. It's recognizing and celebrating the idea that it's often the little things that have the most profound impacts on us. So one of our goals when we talk about hearing loss advocacy, it's multifaceted. We try to explore the way the world can be more sound friendly by improving accessibility, by working with bands to reduce the risk of hearing loss. So at all of our shows, we provide sub-packs and they need backpacks that feed into the PA system. And they take the vibrations of the music and send it in the person wearing it. At all of our shows, we work with artists to establish what we call sound friendly decibel limits. And these are zones, more or less, that we try to hone an artist in on so that when you come to a show, you should never walk away with your ears hurting. And we're very conscious about that. At all of our shows, we provide free ear protection for everybody that comes.
How do you choose your music
That's a great, great question. I look for artists and musicians that can share and just and understanding and recognizing just how lucky it is to be able to do what we do, to be where we are. And so doing, you find some artists that are more engaged in it and some artists that are less engaged in it. At the end of the day, I would venture to say that almost 99% of every artist that's come in here has fallen in love with what we do. They share in a common vision of what we do. And when you bring that together with the fantastic audiences that we have, you get these moments that we chase.
Moments like tonight. And thank you so much for inviting us in.
Y'all doing all right out there?
Yeah. We'll be right back.
love with me, I'll take you to eat with me at Taco Bell, and then you'll be like, fuck, you are not, I am not in love with you, you are nasty. No one should eat their food that disgusting. That is what I say when someone's in my DMs and they say something gross. I'm like, you want to take me to Taco Bell? You will take that back. Either way, I get free Taco Bell, so I'm cool with it. I'm going to give these guys a break for a minute. I'm going to get up here and play some acoustic songs, so try not to talk over me too much. My new thing is calling people out. I played a room down in Atlanta, and it was really, you know, like $40 a person to get in, and people drove a good way to come, and then this one fucking asshole just wanted to, like, talk. And so I stopped mid-song and asked him if I was bothering him. And everybody clapped. And then this one lady goes, yeah, we're... And I was like, where were you at 5 minutes ago? I get ready to leave, and this dude's like 6'4", you know, 280 pounds. I was like, yeah, I stood up to you. I'm such a badass, right? Anyways, that's my spiel. But if you guys wanted to know what's going on in my life, hopefully have a record out soon-ish. I'll have a new single out in the beginning of 2020, but have a nice full-length record for you guys. Been working out there with Mr. Sadler Vaden in Nashville, and I've been making some good friends, you know? I'm not gonna say their names because this is live streamed, and they might be like, we are not your friends, so that would be awkward, so I'm not gonna say anything, but I've made some friends, so I'm a little proud about that. Yeah. Well, I didn't wanna have to write this. Yeah, I hate when I talk about you. Anything is better than the silence that you've been putting me through.
Hell no, I don't regret. And why?
Somebody requested this song. I'm gonna play it. It's a sad one. So alone, and I done drank about a fifth of Jack. I'm feeling like shit, but I'm not turning back. I'd like to call you up, see where you are, but I'll just pass out here in my car. Could never forget July 19th. That evening you and I got back from the beach, and I crashed your place. Held you so tight, it was one hell of a special night. And I do not know that I could ever move on, but I write about you some of these songs. I'll continue to love you. They were beating my heart till that last damn beat falls apart.
As we do at this time in the show, we always give the artist the final note. And Morgan Wade, thank you so much for being a part of Roots2Rock.
Thanks for having me. I appreciate it. Thank you.
We really appreciate it. You've had a great year.
Yeah.
Just go over, you're working on an album. Who are you working with? And
Sadler Vaden, Jason Isbell's lead guitar player, out in Nashville. We've been recording, got a lot of tracks done, so now we're just kind of working with labels and got one kind of locked down to release something in 2020, so full length.
That's awesome. And as you've been doing a lot of festivals, Floyd Native.
Yeah.
How are you handling all of this success?
It's been trying to take like a step back too, I've been gone a lot. and traveling and doing a lot of stuff. So I try to come back home and try to remain as grounded as I can and, you know, taking care of that kind of stuff and not being too engrossed in social media, you know, trying to take a step back from that. But it's nice to come home. You know, it's been nice to be home the last couple of days and hang out.
When we were talking earlier, I asked you to describe your music. You said Nashville was trying to get a handle on what type of music you're doing. How do you create, and do you follow a specific genre, or do you just whatever comes out?
You know, I spent so long with my accent, you know, being told like, oh, country music. Really the stuff that I'm doing now out there in Nashville is definitely not country music, you know, more rock, pop kind of stuff. So just kind of, you know, I don't want to like limit myself to doing just one thing. You know, I think that if you're inspired to do multiple different things, and you should be able to do that, you know, instead of just putting yourself in a box. And people get a little, you know, upset if they hear you one way and then you put something else out that's different. But I think that that's great to be creative and to continue to grow. You know, you don't want everything to sound the same. So right now it's just like Sadler and everybody that I'm working with out in Nashville, they're allowing me to just to do what I want, you know, and to be creative and just be honest. As long as I can be honest and real and don't have to hold back, then, you know, that's the best part.
I was just going to ask you if you felt that your honesty in your songwriting was one of the reasons that you have gained such a following.
I think so. I think I'm very open about, you know, mental health and sobriety and stuff like that. You know, a lot of the stuff that people are afraid to talk about that they shouldn't be afraid to talk about. And it helps me just as much as, you know, if it helps somebody else. You know, if I help one person to be able to talk about something that they want to talk about, you know, that's enough for me. But, yeah, being, you know, we're in a very shallow world. You know, everything's shallow and not as it seems. So to try to just be as genuine and honest as possible, you know, that's what I got to do, you know.
And you said maybe August for the new album.
Yeah, that's kind of how, you know, things get ballparked around. But, you know, definitely 2020 before the winter, you know, and get some new stuff out. Right now I'll have outs tonight that I've done with Sadler. But, you know, trying to get the other stuff rolling. And it's a process, but, you know, you get a little anxious because, like, I want it out. But I know why, you know, I've got such a great team of people that I'm working with right now that, you know, they know exactly what they're doing. And when we have something out, it's just going to be great. You know, the stuff keeps getting better, so I'm really happy about it.
Well, we're looking forward to it. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate it.